Get it on. Got to get it on. No choice but to get it on. Jerry O'Connell is in studio. Good to see you, Jerry.
Adam, what an honor.
Jerry brought us two twins. How old are they?
They are 7 months old. I'm sorry. I know that's not very cool of me, but my wife is working today, and we don't have any help. And I figured if anybody was cool with it, you would be. I am ashamed. I'm embarrassed. I feel like I'm like... I feel like
twins.
Michael Keaton in a 1980s film, but it has to be done.
Mr. Mom, I have twins, so I understand. I feel you. Now, you have twin girls.
We do. We probably could afford someone to take care of them during the day.
I was going to suggest that, yeah.
But I'll tell you, in all honesty, and I'd be into that, but my wife does not want to go down that road just yet.
Rebecca.
She wants one of us to be around them. Mm-hmm. At all times, she feels that's very important to her, and which I completely understand. And that's
so
her.
No nanny.
No nanny.
And when do you think you might, like, after they go to college or something like that, they might be able to hook them up with a nanny?
I'm hoping
because it's never going to be a good time.
Let me tell you what it is. Right now, I am not working.
Mm-hmm.
I'm hoping I get a job, and then I am forced to leave the house, and my wife has a job, and
right.
I'm going to say, listen, I care more about this job than I do my children.
Sure.
It's time for me to leave.
Well, to be fair...
Hold on a second. Girls, shut up. We're doing a podcast. Zip it.
Hold on, Jerry. Put the belt back in the pants, please. I'll not tolerate it. People at home that are just listening who can't see this, Jerry, just reach for a studded belt. Jerry, please, no. Rebecca, if you're listening, this is the best argument I can make for getting a nanny. Jerry literally started to undo his belt. I pray it was to beat them with the belt, now that I think about it. So, Jerry, yeah.
It was
as long
to
as
choke you with it, Adam.
Okay.
I want to choke you just to the point of unconsciousness and then keep you conscious.
You know what? That would bother a lot of guys, but I actually pay for that.
Adam, it feels a lot better if somebody's choking you.
I want to go out like Carradine. I was saying about Carradine.
I couldn't find photos, man. I looked.
Oh, you looked for...
Did you find them?
No, my feeling on all that stuff is... I miss the days when Carradine's assistant or the hotel manager or the housekeeper would find the guy
and cover
with his wang out and the phone cord around his neck, pull him out of the closet, put him in a red, white, and blue gi, put nunchucks in his hands,
really,
and
funny.
Just lay him on the bed and say, that's where I found him.
That is so funny.
Because historically, God knows how many people we found in compromising positions. Like,
yeah.
Who, out of these, all the guys who signed the Declaration of Independence or signed all the founding fathers, right?
Yeah.
All those guys. I'll bet you at least half those guys either died of syphilis or died in their mistress or whatever. But what did they do? They pulled them out, they cleaned them up, and we didn't talk about it.
They did some bad stuff, yeah.
Yeah. I mean, human nature has not changed that much in a couple hundred years, right? They were weird back then, too, right?
I am going to blame it on, I think it's digital images.
Yeah.
I think it's digital images. Not even like the superhighway. I'm not even going to go that broad.
Right.
I'm going to say specifically images, digital images that you can quickly email and stuff.
Is there going to be a celebrity or a person or like, I mean, my feeling is, and by the way, these cameras are now, they have cameras. I was just looking through the Sky Mall the other day and they have like cameras that fit into your car keychain and stuff like that. I mean, there's going to be film of everyone naked, right? Like, there won't be a person from this point on that you won't be able to see having sex or nude pictures of or what have you. I mean, it used to be a celebrity had to pose for Playboy, and then you would have nude pictures of them.
Yeah.
Now it's just their old boyfriend took one on his iPod and his iPhone, and that's it, right?
I'm old school. There may be some images of me naked, but I mean, I don't do those, like, my wife and I don't do those where we pause with each other. Adam, can I put these kids in your studio? In the other room.
Yeah, go ahead.
Girls, that's it. You're not allowed to stay in here with the grown-ups anymore. Bye. See ya.
Jerry has the double-decker stroller,
nice
by the
you.
Way, that looks
Man,
like it's
I'm so,
one of those high-speed so jogging strollers. Ah, that's all right.
I am ashamed.
Don't be ashamed. So Rebecca's working. You're in between gigs. What's Rebecca working on?
Wait, I want to talk about... I did see the Erin Andrews tape. I saw it Do you know who I'm talking about, from the ESPN group?
Yes, I saw that too. Yes, somebody like literally put a camera in a gym bag or bored a hole in the side of a wall or did something.
Yeah.
And then there's part of me that feels bad, but then there's another part of me that goes, well, what am I supposed to do? I'm over at Kimmel's house, and he does the, come here, come here, come here. And then you go over to the computer, and the next thing you know, there's two chicks crapping in a cup or something.
Yeah.
And you're like, how about a little heads up? Yeah. So she's the reporter from ESPN who's foxy. And the point is, this is my point. Either you're going to volitionally take pictures of yourself in the nude and sell them to Playboy, or somebody's going to find a picture of you and put it on the internet. And then once it's out, you know, it's kind of like this. You ever watch, remember you used to see like Tyson fight Mike Tyson, total animal in the ring, right?
Yeah.
And
he was,
there'd
he was
be that good. Thing where it'd be the fifth round and he'd be kicking the crap out of someone and the bell would ring just clearly. They're like ding, ding, ding. And then he'd whack the guy really hard, like good 3 seconds after the bell just rang and completely scramble the guy's eggs. Like, I mean, just cold cock him. Sometimes it was in the back of the head. Either way, it was Mike Tyson hitting you with a short right hook, right?
Okay.
And then the ref would go, hey, 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 come on now. None of that. Come on, none of that. And he'd walk back to his corner. But tell that to the guy who just got the concussion. He doesn't lose any points. He doesn't get anything deducted. He doesn't get anything. Just a guy going, hey, hey, knock it off. And the guy staggers back to his corner who got hit after the bell. I feel the same way with all this nude stuff. Somebody sneaks a camera in a gym bag, takes a picture of your famous wife naked, throws it on the internet. Everyone sees it. And then at a certain point, a judge goes, hey, knock it off.
Right.
But everyone already saw the picture, right? It's already on their computer now.
Right.
So
right.
Just like the guy staggering back to the corner, a lot of good it does him
right.
to have the ref tell Tyson, hey, knock it off.
Well, I think they are going to press charges against, they're going to try and find the person who
but
did
you
it.
Saw her nude, didn't you?
I did.
Well,
I
then it's then your work is done. You're married to Rebecca Romijn.
Yeah.
Do you really need to look at other blondes naked?
Listen, I think it's the fact that it's secret footage, you know? I think mm-hmm. it dates back to, if you remember, a classic film, Porky's, where someone drilled a hole in a wall and
sure.
to look it into the girl's locker room.
Right.
And, I mean, that there's excitement in that.
No,
you know?
I agree.
And
it's
I think
titillated.
If someone had posed for those photos, you know, if Erin Andrews had posed for those in a magazine, I'm not sure that we'd be as into it as if someone surreptitiously
yes, no,
did that.
That's what happens every time. It's like,
mind you, whoever did do that should get in a lot of trouble. That's some bad stuff.
I know. But it's like Lisa Rinna wants to pose for Playboy, and you're like, I don't need to see. Like, it's a catch-22. I don't need to see anyone naked who wants to be naked.
Well,
I want to see people who are nude who don't want to be nude.
Maybe Lisa should act like Harry Hamlin, her husband. Drilled a hole in their bathroom wall and taped her, like, peeing and pooping. And
that I could masturbate to. I do. And by the way, you're laughing, but there's a whole new branch of porn. Let's bring the twins back in for this discussion. Where the guy does that thing where he goes into, like, the soft swirl yogurt shop and there's the hot blonde behind the counter. And he's like, hey, man. How much to come out to the van and give me a little, you know, whatever.
Oh, so it's getting people off the street.
Yeah, porn. Well, it's not. Because obviously the chick at the soft swirl yogurt shop.
Oh, is a plant.
Yeah, isn't really going to just go into this guy's primered van and
yeah.
give him a blowjob
yeah.
for $80. But they do there's a whole new kind of porn where it's the Jerry porn where they're like, hey, you know, this isn't a porn movie. These are civilians, and the guy gets out $1,000, and he's like, let's go into the back room. And when you watch it, it's kind of like, oh, yeah, this is a normal, normal chick.
I have not seen those,
oh.
but it sounds hot.
Let me tell you something.
You know what would be really hot, too, is if we could watch that, and I could choke you with my black studded belt
yeah.
and keep you just at consciousness.
Just in that weird, rarefied air, that ether between conscious, alive and no pulse at all. I got to tell you, the one perk, Jerry, to the old lady hitting the set, going out for 12, 14 hours a day, and you being stuck home alone with the twins without the heavy set Guatemalan chick running around the house, is you porn. That is the one perk for being Mr. Mom, and you're not taking advantage of it. You put the kids down for a nap, and now it's Pops, time for Pops to get a little quality time in.
I do have to say, that quality time, because I am around my two daughters, I find it, I'm someone who needs to be very much alone for those intimate moments.
Really?
Like, when I say, like, alone, I mean, like, empty house alone.
Really?
Yeah.
So even if the
sometimes at work, like in a workplace bathroom, I'm okay. But at home, I'm just too afraid.
So you mean even if the kids are upstairs in the cribs, no downstairs on the laptop?
You know, let me just say no to that. First of all, because they're only 7 months old, so you do have to sort of be in their vicinity. You can't, you have to sort of be around them.
Now listen, you're talking to a guy who has twins. They're three, and they're still, you know, one of them's alive. So I feel like I did a, you know, pretty decent job of rearing. You know, now, you know, it's funny when you think about that, like being alone. You know, when you watch those, I was just watching Michael Irving being like inducted into the Hall of Fame in football, and of course, the playmaker for the Dallas Cowboys.
Right,
and
right,
they do
right.
that thing where it's like, he was raised in a one-bedroom house with 17 brothers and sisters, and your thoughts always turn to, wow, man, cramped and squalor and stuff like that. But you really have to think about beating off. I mean, imagine you. You need the entire neighborhood to be medevaced out of your city in order to squeeze one off. And here you are, Michael Irvin. I bet Michael Irvin squeezed one off in a crowded elevator.
Yeah, no, it's funny you say that because, you know, he was obviously very, very athletic, probably very just filled with testosterone, especially during those teenage years.
Oh, maybe that was it.
He was competing at a very high level.
Oh!
At the highest level. He was a playmaker even then.
Maybe it's because he had a lot of pent-up energy that he wasn't burning off at home.
I do want to say, I like where your mind is going, Adam, and that's why, you know, myself and hundreds of millions of others love you and the way your mind works. But that is not the first thing I think of when Michael Irvin gets inducted into the NFL.
Really?
Hall of Fame.
But surely when he talks about having 9 brothers and 14 sisters,
it would have never entered my mind.
Really?
And I have a pretty dirty mind.
Wow.
I just want you to know how dirty your mind is that you think of how did Michael Irvin touch himself in such a crowded household. Well, and you are completely right. And you really look at things from such an interesting angle.
He loves his mama, and he's pissed at me because I did Kimmel with him, and I basically was explaining to him that white guys don't love their mama. You know, I mean, we're okay with our mama, but you guys, you black guys, you love your mama.
That's pretty funny.
You know what I mean?
I don't think he'll be mad at you for that long. I don't know him at all personally.
Oh, that wasn't it. I kept going.
Well, oh, really?
Well, he was like, why don't you love your mama? And I said, look, your mama worked 3 jobs, right? And she was like, yeah, and then managed to come home and cook a meal and do all. My mama laid around the house. As a matter of fact, your mama came over to my mama's house and cleaned it. And my mama made me like a Hot Pocket, and that was it. So why should I love my mama? And then he was laughing, but later on I think he got pissed that I mentioned that his mama was cleaning my mama's house.
That, I don't think he'll, I think he's a pretty funny guy. He takes himself, I actually did meet him once at a bar in Los Angeles. We were watching Monday Night Football, believe it or not. Mm. And he was there, and he couldn't have been nicer, I said, hello, playmaker, it is an honor to meet you.
And he was like, Kangaroo Jack!
No, I don't even think he recognized me. But he asked me if I knew that guy from The Man Show because he's looking for him. That's a joke. I thought he was funny on the Joe Buck Show when he had that really funny line about white-on-white crime.
Yeah.
So I don't think he's afraid of
a little controversy. Well, what he does is he laughs and laughs and laughs, and then when he gets off the air, he goes, I'm going to kill you. Yeah. So let's forget about Michael for a second. Let's talk about you.
No,
you had 14 brothers and sisters growing up. You grew up, Long Island?
No, I grew up in Manhattan.
Manhattan.
In New York City.
And your parents did what?
My father, mid-level advertising guy.
And mom?
Was a public school teacher, special ed.
And then how did you get into acting?
Stand By Me was... remember the movie Stand By Me, directed by Rob Reiner?
Of course, great movie.
They were holding pretty big auditions. Not big auditions, but sort of like, you know, they were reaching out to, they weren't just going the route of, like, Disney Channel. Right. I guess there wasn't a Disney Channel back then. They weren't just going the route of, like, the Tatum O'Neills of the day.
They didn't want a bunch of familiar faces.
Right.
I agree with that because, you know, it's a distraction. I mean, it, you know, on one hand, it's kind of cool. On the other hand, you see the outsiders and you're like, oh, look, there's Tom Cruise and there's Patrick Swayze. And it's like,
it's always pretty cool to see the outsiders. Though,
all right. Maybe like, you're right. Horrible example. But it can't. I like seeing especially a story like that told with people that I don't recognize because it makes it believable. And I don't want to see Dakota Fanning in your role. That's all I'm saying.
Yeah, no, it was down to me and her.
Which is amazing. An unborn Dakota Fanning.
No, but I went to a school that was sort of a performance art school. It's called Clinton School for the for Writers and Artists or something.
Really?
Sort of in Chelsea.
You had to get into that school.
Yes, it was a smaller school.
You were a gifted child.
They call it a satellite school. Mm-hmm. To be honest, because I was too afraid to go to the regular junior high school.
Really?
Or I was not. My parents were too afraid. And the regular junior high was one block from my house, and this one was about four or five blocks.
Were you a chubby kid, or did you pack on the pounds like De Niro did for Raging Bull?
I purposely put those on for the role. Really? No, I was overweight as a child, yes.
Oh, so you can't go to a public school if you're a chubby kid anyway, because then
you know,
you're the
chubby
kid. You know,
it's actually not that bad. It actually works out in your favor, because people also do give you a little bit of... you're a little more intimidating than the smaller kids.
Well, it is true. Like, I always remember the chubby kids, and no matter what you wanted to say about them, they still had 35 pounds on your scrawny 60-pound ass. And there was that sort of feeling that they could crush you just because of the size. I mean, just because they're sheer mass.
Well, like, there were kids that were larger than me that were definitely bullies. Definitely.
Right.
I was not a bully. I got along with pretty much everybody. Mm-hmm. But people, our biggest problem at our school was people coming from the bigger school or the high school, which was even closer, and preying on the junior high school kids, you know? So it was mostly like kids who were three or four, or if they had most likely had a difficult time getting out of high school, 5 or 6 years older than you.
Right.
Coming back to, you know, take money from
you. How scary that was, like, when you were 11 or 12, a 15 or 16-year-old coming by.
It was really scary.
They're the scariest people on the planet.
It was really scary. And to be honest, I remember a situation where one asked for my money. I wouldn't give it to him. I had a, it was a 25-cent fruit drink in a plastic barrel where you pop the top off. It had foil on it.
Mm-hmm.
And I threw it at him.
Really?
Yeah. And, which was, looking back, a really, like, ballsy move on my part. But I think there was someone of authority there. Like, we had some problems in our school, so we had a couple of teachers who were watching us after school.
Do you ever get, you know, there's that thing in life where you become the age of the person, like, my family are all pretty much losers, and, like, I'm... You know, approximately the age my dad was when my parents got divorced.
Right.
And my dad didn't have enough money to put a down payment down on put a cleaning deposit down on a one-bedroom apartment in North Hollywood.
Right.
So we had to go live at my grandparents' house for a few months.
Okay.
And you think, at the time, it's sort of like, all right, this is how life is. But then you get to be that age and you go, what the fuck? You didn't have $300 for an apartment?
Yeah.
Now... Fast forward or go back to when you're in high school. When I was in high school, 16 years old, 17, whatever, I played sports and attempted to get laid. There's never, if one of my friends said, hey man, let's go back to the old junior high and pick on some eighth graders, I would have been like, are you fucking high?
Yeah.
What do you want to do that for? What did that 12-year-old do to you? And by the way, you're 17. You really want to go screw with a 12-year-old? Like, what the fuck? When you're 12 and the 17-year-old is fucking with you, it seems normal. But then you get to be 17 and you're like, what the hell's wrong with that guy?
Yeah.
Could you imagine when you were in the 10th or 11th grade going back and screwing with a 6th grader?
I could not. But, I mean, I have to think that the people who did screw with, and I want to say me, us, there was a group of us that they took issue with.
assholes. They're just need to be shot.
They're
right?
just very. I think they're probably very insecure.
And, well, they're super stupid.
And I can't imagine that they've amounted to anything in their lives.
I would hope they were just raped in prison and killed that way.
But it's really funny. I remember this one guy I threw this thing at. He swore he was going to get me, and there was a like. I'm going to go with a couple weeks there where I would walk around New York City in a state of fear looking sure. for this guy. And it was actually a really interesting, I mean, it was a funny thing to sort of go through is to always be scared, you know?
Yeah.
But that being said, I'll tell you what I really took issue with is when I went to high school, guys who were older who would go out with girls in my high school.
Yeah.
So guys who would come around in their cars and pick right. girls up.
Right.
Who were adults.
Right.
And I first know. Of all, it's illegal. Secondly, I remember, you know, when I turned like 23 or 24 being like, wow, could I really go have sex with a 16-year-old and go pick her up at high school? And
I know.
Like be like, feel good about that? And like proudly pull up in my BMW 3 Series convertible.
Right.
And be like, hey, what's up? Yeah. Hey, yeah. Well, come on in. Let's go.
Let's go drink a Yoo-Hoo down yeah. at the park. It's awesome. Yeah, I know. Oh, you got pubic hair? Really? Prove it. Yeah, you want to see my Letterman jacket? It's got a date on it, 9 years earlier than when you're going to graduate. It's awesome. I lettered and track. Yeah, I know. It's so skeezy. It's like, it's just weird.
That's the one that always freaked me out.
And
you know?
It's also historically, when you hear about it, too, it's a little weird. Although we give everyone a pass, but it's like, well, Elvis met a 14-year-old Priscilla yeah. Presley when he yeah. was in the Army.
Yeah.
And him and Priscilla used to spend long nights at 14?
Yeah.
Not 16-and-a-half-year-old Priscilla Presley. Yeah. And like when you hear about like Sonny Bono met a 4-year-old Cher when yeah. he was 29 and he brought her into his apartment. It's like, what? There is that sort of thing. Like historically, it all sounds really cool now, but it's really weird that like Sonny and Cher, Elvis, I'm not sure. I don't know. Even if the point is there's a massive difference between 22 and 15. There's not a massive difference between 32 and 39, but there's a massive difference between when you're in your early 20s, you've been out of high school, and you've experimented with drugs, you've gotten laid, you got your own apartment, all that, and you're going after some 15-year-old.
It's just wrong.
But it's wrong.
It's really wrong.
But if you could wrap your studded belt around my neck while I thought about a 14-year-old Priscilla Presley, that would be awesome.
It's just not good. I'll tell you, I actually knew a guy. I went to college with a guy who dated a girl who was a teenager in high school. And my brother and I, who both went to college together and knew this guy, we were like, hey, man, you know, this is it. This
right.
is it.
We're it's not creepy.
We're not hanging out anymore. And he was like, well, you know, we really love each other. And I was like,
worse.
No, man, it's not cool. There's nothing cool about it.
I'll tell you.
And I've seen him a couple times since then. And even then, I'm like, yeah, yeah.
It's weird. It's like, yeah, it's like seeing a guy. It's like once in a while, you'll see a guy just kick his dog really hard. Or do something weird like that, and you'll go, no, I don't want to hang out with this guy. You know, you get turned off. I mean, this is the equivalent to, you know, you've dated a chick for a couple of weeks, you go down on her, and woo. Seeing a guy, like, punch his dog or smack his kid or something like that.
I have a new thing with my dogs. I have a bottle of water, and I spray them.
Now, and that's cool.
It's pretty rude, actually, and it really annoys them.
What kind of dogs are they?
Listen, we have a couple of little dogs that we rescued at this place, Much Love, which is a big reason why I'm here. Big charity event coming up August 22nd. But we have a couple of little rescue dogs, which we got before we had kids. And now that we have children, that void has been filled.
Sure.
So we're stuck with these two little mutts. I'm joking. We love them. But they're crazy, you know, and now that the kids are here, they're really crazy, and I have a little water bottle, and I spray them with it.
So you do, going back now, you do Stand By Me at, what are you, 10 years old?
I was 11.
11 years old.
And it was sort of found through my junior high school, which is for writers and artists,
mm-hmm.
and I went in for one audition. My mother came in with me because she was sure it was a scam of some sort.
Sure.
A friend that my mother had worked with was scammed out of money for photos.
Right.
And had to pay hundreds of dollars for her children to get...
Great movie, by the way.
8x10s.
And so you went in, you get the part. So you got River Phoenix in that.
Right.
You got...
Will Wheaton.
The Corys
and Corey Feldman.
Now, what's Will Wheaton up to these days? Do you know?
I don't know. I don't know. I don't know. I read on a Google alert he had written on a blog that he was offended by something I said, that he was rude to me once on set, and he wrote on a blog that he was heartbroken that he heard that.
Really?
I and didn't he, mean that. And you know,
you're
it's
both
just
11?
Because,
who gives a shit?
Well, I just I was asked, you know, what was it like working on that film? And I said, some of the guys were kind of rude because I had not worked professionally and I didn't know what a mark was and I didn't know what a camera was.
You didn't know what stage left and stage right.
I didn't know
and
what anything was.
And downstage and all
and
that.
And a couple of times, those guys were a little bit older. A couple of times, I said they were a little snarky with me.
Right.
Not that I gave a shit, because
look, everyone knows the reason Will Wheaton isn't working in this town is because he's a colossal prick. Now, let's be honest.
I don't know if that's the case.
Everyone knows that.
Is that really
I go
true?
Home, I ask my nanny, why isn't Will Wheaton working? She goes, huge attitude, huge prick.
Well,
everyone in this town knows that. Pull off the freeway. The guy selling the oranges, ask him why Will Wheaton is not working.
Yeah.
He'll tell you, huge prick, in broken English, but huge prick. Everyone knows it.
Listen, I think maybe you're...
No, I'm
you're
not overstating
him
this.
With Ryan O'Neill
no,
or something?
No! He makes Ryan O'Neill look like Sir Walter Raleigh. Are you kidding me? Will Wheaton is out of control. Anyone who's been on a set with Wheaton will never work with him again. He's out of control.
Anyway, I should apologize to him. He was very upset on his blog. And
his
I just
blog.
Read it through a Google alert. I don't follow the blog, but supposedly he's got one.
Well, I
got
to tell you, out of the four, I'd say you landed on your feet.
Well, also, Kiefer Sutherland was in that film.
Oh, yeah. Well, screw it then. They're not doing as good as he is.
Yeah, he's really... He's rolling.
I forgot Kiefer. Kiefer's like, Kiefer was the guy we're talking about, that 17-year-old guy who fucks with the 11-year-old guy.
In the film he was.
Yeah,
I don't
the
think
film.
He was like that in real life.
No,
I think
huge
he was
cock in real life. Prick.
I think he was a... actually, he's not a huge
People
prick.
Won't work with him.
I want to tell you...
Ask anyone about Kiefer Sutherland, and they'll tell you, huge dick. No one wants to work with that
That's
guy.
Impossible. I'm going to tell you a story.
Prick.
I'm going to tell you a story that's going to make
Ego
you feel differently.
Maniac. Okay, go
I on. Was in New York. Stand By Me had come out. I was about 13 years old. It had been out about a year, maybe 2 years, a year. Mm-hmm. And I was not really a part of the Hollywood community after that film. They did not embrace me. I was still in
You're
the same...
You were just a fat kid from the movie.
I was... In the same public school I was in when
right.
I made the film, I, you know, Corey Feldman had moved on to,
sure,
to the vampire movie. What was that one?
Yeah,
with Kiefer Sutherland
yeah.
as well.
Dude, Where's My Vampire?
No, not Vampire Diaries. We get confused.
Yeah.
Lost Boys.
Lost Boys.
Lost
yeah.
Boys.
It was Lost Boys. Yeah.
River Phoenix had gone on to Academy Award winning performances.
Sure.
In Running on Empty.
Sure.
Will Wheaton was on Star Trek, and I was nowhere. And I was at the Feast of San Gennaro with a woman trying to get some. A girl in my school trying to get some.
Really?
And
now, were you still big at this point?
No, I was starting to pull together.
Really?
And
what were you doing at the feast then, if you weren't so big?
We were going on rides, playing games.
All right.
Eating cotton candy.
Aha. So you're trying to get with a chick.
Yeah, I was trying to get to second base, possibly third.
Mm-hmm.
Kids were on third base at that point. No home runs at that point, though. We're talking about the eighth grade.
Sure.
But saw Kiefer Sutherland at the fair.
Uh-huh.
And he was giving me money, hanging out with my date and I. This was when Bright Lights Big City had just come out,
sure.
just to let you know where you were in the world.
He was trying to bang your date.
No, it's not the case. He was with another very attractive
world-class
woman.
World-class Coxman.
He,
sure.
And woman, I believe I did
enough.
Get to...
Not enough.
I believe I did get to second base with this girl.
Really?
Yeah. I did not get to third, because I know for a fact I didn't get to third base until high school.
Mm-hmm.
That's where you use your finger, third base.
I think so, yeah.
And
although not today.
What, third base today is like...
It's anal. It is. Don't laugh. We have young twins. I'm telling you. They've changed the diamond. They've changed it. Yeah.
That should be your bit, Corolla.
Dry anal rape is third base. Did you know that? Okay. Wait.
Tri-anal.
Do you have the belt?
Yeah.
All right. So
flying pressure.
All right. So you get to second base, but Kiefer, because he's a cool guy.
I'm just giving you a story that you're confusing him with someone who might not be cool. He is
Kiefer's
cool.
Cool guy. Comes and gives you some money for gelato.
I did see him here locally in Los Angeles. There is a chain of fancy restaurants, not a chain of like lower end restaurants, called Hamburger Hamlet.
Sure.
Which is a chain of hamburger restaurants, fancy leather seated hamburger restaurants. And I saw him there at the bar, and I hadn't seen him for years. And I said, "Hey, Kiefer, wow, I got to say, man, that night in 1987, you really helped me out. Remember when I saw you at the feast?" And he had no idea what I was talking about.
That's why he's Kiefer. So he's named after a liquid yogurt drink.
That's funny.
I swear to God, I grew up with something called Kiefer. It was a drinkable yogurt.
My wife buys it, and it sits in our fridge, and it always goes bad, and it's never
even
open.
How do you
know
when it's bad? Because it's always, you know, so viscous, it doesn't come out of the carton.
No, I don't know.
And what's Rebecca working on now?
Oh, a big-time show called Eastwick, based on The Witches of Eastwick for ABC. It's a new drama this fall.
Ah, bitching. So she's got a regular gig.
Yeah, and it's a really good job, and she really likes it, and it's with three other girls, and they're the other witches. And
she likes them?
She loves them.
And it's
funny,
sort of like
I'm the first to make fun of that as well. Like, oh, right. I always ask when she comes home, I'm like, oh, have two of you ganged up on the other
the
one
claws
yet?
Claws come out? Yet?
Yeah, because that's what I'm waiting for, and they really all get along.
So it's like the Cher...
She plays the Cher character, the Michelle Pfeiffer, and the other character.
She plays your kids
she
are crying
plays the
in the
Cher
next room.
Character.
Yeah, she plays the Cher character. So it's sort of based on The Witches of Eastwick, which was another cool movie that it sort of kind of doesn't show up on cable that much.
It doesn't. And I don't know why. Maybe
Stand By Me for my money doesn't show up on cable quite enough either for how good a movie it
I
was.
I gotta say, I think cable the movies that do show up are Bruce Willis action films. I think people like to see those. Their ratings you'll probably see are higher.
I know, but then there's always a bunch of just random shit that I never want to see again that keeps popping up. But
remember when Conan used to be on HBO? Like, That's all it was.
So she's doing that. You guys met, what, about 3 years ago now?
No, about five and a half years ago.
How'd you guys meet?
We met, we originally met when my wife was previously married. We shared an agent and we met at one of his parties. But nothing happened there, I promise you.
Sure.
I wish.
Yeah.
Believe me. I will say this. I do recall being at that party and thinking, well, first of all, she's married, so I thought nothing would come of that. But secondly, I remember thinking, man, I could never, that's way out of my league. That's way out of my league.
Yeah, it is. I mean, it was. I mean, listen, the greatest compliment you can pay to a guy is you're married to a chick who's out of your league.
She is way out of my league.
Yeah, and the thing, obviously she's beautiful, but she's like smart, she's funny, and she's cool, which is kind of the best part.
She is way out of my league.
Wow, I don't know how hot chicks. Most hot chicks don't get that cool. She's very cool. I don't know.
She's from Berkeley. I think that has a lot to do with it. Girls from Berkeley are just cooler.
Did she not go the traditional model route? Like she didn't get shipped off to Europe when she was 13?
No, I think she's just got like hippie-ish parents from Berkeley, and she sort of took everything with a grain of salt. And I don't know. She's a lot like a dude in a lot of senses. I know that's awful. She does not like sports, so that's where she'd fall short of being like a dude.
Right.
But she's very hairy in a lot of places, and she's...
I love that about her. You got that belt? So now, she's doing that. You go from Stand By Me to what? Dry Spell for a while? Just go back and become a student?
I mean, it's funny.
What year was Stand By Me?
I remember thinking of it as in 86 it came out. I remember thinking of it as I remember feeling a little like jealousy of those other guys and they were working. Mm-hmm. I remember feeling that.
Had you been bit by the bug at that point? Did you want to do that?
I think it was a big hit, and I don't think anyone expected it to be a big hit. I remember my father telling me, "Don't tell anyone that I made a film because it will never be released." That people make films all the time and they're never released.
Right.
So thanks, don't go Dad. To school and say I was in a film because I'm going to feel really stupid.
When people go,
when's that movie coming out? And I go, it's not coming out.
Yeah, it's like me with my CBS pilot.
maybe you should have asked my dad for
what
advice.
What happened with that pilot? Jesus. Talk to Jerry's dad, would you please? So,
but I did do some things. I did some, like, a lot of stuff out of New York, you know, just because that's where I lived. So I did some, like, crazy educational show for Scholastic Television, you know?
Yeah. Well, I'm talking about shit that counts,
Jeff. Yeah, you know?
And so the next break for you would be...
It was, I believe, syndicated. That's pretty good.
What year was your next, would you consider your next break?
You know, I'll tell you, I went to NYU... I graduated high school in 91. I went to NYU in 91. I was a freshman at NYU. And over the summer, I got a film, believe it or not, starring Jason Priestley, called Calendar Girl, about three guys who go on a road trip in the late 50s to go find Marilyn Monroe.
Yeah, and like a convertible Cadillac of viewing. Yes.
It was a takeoff of Stand By Me. It was Stand By Me, but here we are 7 years later, which ironically is exactly what... It's ironically exactly what Stand By Me was.
Right.
And Penny Marshall, who executive produced it, who was married to Rob Reiner at the time of Stand By Me.
I know. Their kid went to my grade school, Tracy.
That I did not know. But she said, I want that fat kid from Stand By Me in this.
And you were no longer the fat kid.
And I was in college, and I got a random call. And that's how, that was my next big thing. So how crazy is that? Stand By Me 6 years later. And I'm sorry, 7 years later.
7 years later, and you're hanging with Priestley.
Yeah, which was incredible.
It was a colossal prick, by the way.
Not at all.
Well,
he couldn't have been a bigger star.
Ask anyone.
Let me tell you something. In 1992, when I was with Jason Priestley, Jason Priestley was to the world as Robert Patterson is to the world in 2009. It was crazy.
He was a mega star.
You couldn't walk down. I met him in New York once. I said, let's go to the Carnegie Deli, which is a famous delicatessen on 6th Avenue. I said, let's, or maybe it's 5th Avenue. I think it's 5th Avenue. Hey, let's meet there, and we'll grab a sandwich. And he went, all right, well, just come and meet me in my hotel just so I know where it is, because he wasn't from around New York. Right. And I said, yeah, sure. So I said, I'll meet you downstairs. I'm standing outside, you know. It was before cell phones. I'd call him from a payphone or something. And we walked two blocks, and it took us about an hour and a half, man. And
it,
I remember...
It was Priestley mania.
It was crazy. Yeah. It was crazy.
He was a heartthrob and all that 90210 business. I mean, it was massive.
It was crazy.
So that film came out, got a big release, did all right.
Let me tell you what's so funny about that film. That film, my only other film before that was a film called Stand By Me. I did not take my father's advice again, and I told everyone I went in college with that I was in a film called Calendar Girl with Jason Priestley. And to get ready, because it's going to be big.
Right.
It's going to be really big.
Right.
And I'm probably not going to finish school because I'm going to be big.
Right.
Sure. Priestley big.
Right.
I went to go see the film. They did not have a premiere for the film. I went with my parents, who had moved out to Long Island at this time. I believe I had to go to the Womack Cinemas in Long Island with my parents. I had to drive an hour because it was very difficult to find a theater that was actually carrying the film. I think it was a limited release is what they call it. And we saw a 3 p.m. show. My father, my mother, and I were the only three people in the theater. And I realized I was probably going to be going back to college.
Did your parents have any sort of...
Yeah, I remember watching it. My father...
things to say that...
Yeah, I remember watching it, and I watched it, and I remember saying to my dad, so what did you think, you know? And he went, I thought it was really stupid. I thought it was a really stupid movie. And my mother was like, oh, don't listen to him. It was amazing. It was amazing. Right. And he went, no, that was a dumb movie.
Did he say you were good in it?
No, I think he was upset by the whole thing.
Really? So your dad was like a real artist.
I think he was an artist, you know? I think he was an 80s bohemian guy who raised his kids in Chelsea. Probably angry at the man
because
he didn't make it in advertising.
And
I think probably wanted to be a little edgier. I think a few of his friends had become novelists.
That's kind of a dicky thing to do. I mean, you should... I mean, I don't know what your relationship is with it.
Like, it's really good. It's really good.
All right, so let me see if I can fuck that up for a second.
No,
I think they've done that thing where he went like, well, I'm not in the demo, but I'm sure the girls are going to love it, or something like that. I mean, really, I mean, you shouldn't have told the son it was a stupid move. That must have hurt your feelings.
I have to tell you, I think he did it because he doesn't understand the difference between Goodfellas and Calendar Girl. He thinks...
They're all made for the same people.
He just doesn't understand. I think he says it from a place of ignorance, so...
Oh, you mean, like, in his mind, every film should be Raging Goodfellas Bull. Or Raging Bull.
Every film should be Raging Bull.
I agree with that comment, by the way,
now,
but yes, I know what you're
mind
saying.
Mind you, I do have to say, I do have an early memory of my brother and I making my father take us to Rocky III, starring Sylvester Stallone and Mr. T.
Sure.
And my father being very upset that we made him go see that film.
Really?
Yeah. And being really mad at us.
Really?
Yeah, and saying how stupid
so
it was.
Your dad didn't have a lot of camp in him. I mean, he couldn't get the Clubber Lang's camp, you know, just the fun, just like, you know what I mean? Like, I don't know. That stuff, there's a lot of shitty films that are just fun. I mean, that's a good, shitty, fun film.
Yeah, but I mean, that's
so
just...
your dad's an artist. A little bit of a snob.
A little bit serious. A little bit serious.
A little self-important.
Yeah.
Poop doesn't stink.
I think his poop smells.
Colossal prick. I don't want to be upset with him.
He's not a prick. You know, he's British.
Oh, he is. Oh, so he thinks he's better than we are. I got it. Now I get it. And how's your brother doing, The Bachelor?
He's good, man. He's doing real well.
Oh, I heard the man.
He's
hacking the man.
Yeah.
At the end of Good Man, it's like when you start off with, well, what's he doing for work? Right now.
He's trying to figure it out. He's an investor in a restaurant, you know. I mean, what do you want me to say, you know?
Mm-hmm. Well, did you watch The Bachelor and cringe, or was it cool to see your
You know what's funny? I have to say, I played a big part in him being in The Bachelor.
You did.
My wife played an even bigger role in him being in The Bachelor. She had a friend who was a producer on that show.
Uh-huh.
And they were looking to cast another singer, a male singer.
Mm-hmm.
To be The Bachelor. So they wanted someone with a bit of a name.
Four seasons ago, right?
I think a little longer. They were trying to spice up the ratings. I think it was about five seasons ago.
Well, you were married, right? Or you were with
Rebecca?
No, I was
not married. We were with each other.
Okay.
Anywho, sort of my wife said, oh my God, your brother should do this, and suggested it to her friend. And my friend said, would he be willing to do it? And here's a guy who's not really acting anymore, you know? I mean... Sort of right. came out to L.A. to do that. It's not really happening.
Mm-hmm.
And I said, you know, you should look into this. This is going to be a lot of fun. Also, I think my wife and I loved watching that show, loved, you know, the sort of craziness that went on there.
Do you watch The New? Or do you watch The
you know,
Bachelorette
yeah,
and all
yeah.
that stuff?
We watch all those shows.
I just love the part. I saw none of the last season of The Bachelorette. The only one I saw is where the guy was a singer. He had a band.
Yeah.
And he looked like trouble.
That's a prerequisite.
And then
yeah.
the other guy came back, who was like the airline pilot, and he's like, I got to be honest with you. This dude's got a girlfriend. And that guy was just like sitting there going, I have no idea what he's talking about. And I'm like, I love to see guys squirm, you know? Like, he's like, one of the guys who got kicked off like 2 weeks earlier came back and he did that, you know, I love you so much. I have such strong feelings for you. And I know I can't be the one, but he has a girlfriend. He told me. And they do that thing where it's like when they go, hey, man, when we were in the hot tub, remember you're telling me about your girlfriend?
Yeah, yeah.
And the guy's got to go, I have no idea what you're talking about.
And did they play it back?
No, they didn't have the footage of it. But they just kept – it's just the idea that somebody unprovoked would just come in and go, here's what he said to me.
Yeah.
And the guy was starting to sweat and squirm, and he did that, hey, man – and then he started doing this one, which always means people are lying. I'm going to be 100,000,000,000% honest, okay? Okay, I'm going to be honest with you as I can be right now with somebody, okay? Okay? So as honestly as I can honestly be. You want me to be honest?
I want you to be honest.
Okay, if you want me to be honest, I can totally, over 1,000,000% with total honesty say, the more you say honest and the more you say right now.
Did he have a girlfriend?
Yes, he had a girlfriend.
You know, also, I have to say, and I don't mean to sound like my dad, but you are confusing this with reality. Just because it's called reality television doesn't necessarily
mean reality.
That.
So how much of your brother Charlie's
Listen, it was really painful to watch. First of all, they get them so liquored up.
Yeah,
so
they do.
So to see my brother so liquored up on TV.
I gotta say, I thought your brother was an alcoholic from watching it. Like, I was like, God, this guy's got a problem with the booze, because he was pretty lit every time they put the camera on him.
Yeah.
Because they just serve the champagne and get everyone kind of loosey-goosey, and then they say a bunch of stupid stuff.
Yeah. He was buzzed on that show, you know? He was pretty buzzed. So it was a little, what I thought was going to be a lot of fun to watch became cringe-inducing.
Really?
Became, I'm not cringe-inducing, full-on cringe factor.
It was like freaky watching your brother.
To the point where I couldn't watch the last few.
So you're watching your...
And it's only because he's so shithoused throughout the whole thing.
You're watching your brother up there, and he goes, you know, I wanted to pork this chick, but I had whiskey dick. So she started sucking, but it didn't work. And then I threw up. I threw up on her back. Anyway, who's got that pitcher of margaritas? I don't remember much from that whole thing other than I remember
but thinking, that's what
this
it was,
guy drinks a lot.
Yeah.
I would drink too, and don't get me wrong. It just, if someone just filmed me the times I was drunk, you'd go, wow, that guy drinks a lot.
Yeah.
Because... Didn't roll cameras.
You know, I mean, here's the other thing. There was a big article in the New York Times on Sunday as well. You should check it out, about how they, what they do to people on reality shows, how they deprive them of sleep, you know, and I'll tell you a really funny story about that show in particular and how kind of evil it is, you know, and how sick and wrong it is. My parents, who we've talked about,
they were on the show.
They were on the show and they were doing it. So a couple of producers split them up and say, we want to talk to you in this bedroom and you in this bedroom. So my mother goes in, and the producer says to my mother, you're being boring. This is all boring. Yeah. And my mother goes, I don't know what to say. And they go, it's boring. What do you think of this girl? And she's like, she seems okay. Well, do you have any problems with her? No, not really. Got my dad and said, you know, why aren't you guys drinking more? And my father said, well, we don't want to drink if we're going to be on camera. And they were like, come on, drink. This is being boring. They pulled my parents aside 3 or 4 times and scolded them for being boring.
Oh, because I saw your dad, and he's like, calendar girl sucked ass. That was my other son. I don't talk to his uncreative ass anymore. But my son with the talent, he's porking this chick, and she's okay. All right, so, yeah, and let me say this. I've talked to Dr. Drew about this many times.
Well, his show is great. His show is great. And I want to defend him for a second.
Go ahead. I'm not going to attack him, but go ahead.
Let me tell you what Drew does. And I watch his show religiously, pun intended. He just puts together a crazy bunch of people, and they're going to do whatever the hell they're going to do. They're psychotic.
They're sober, which is... Essentially,
they're
it's weird
psychotic.
Because taking away their drugs is like the producers giving them drugs on another show.
And
makes
I think
them
his
psychotic.
Intentions are good. To be honest, the best intentioned reality show in the world, though, is Intervention. If you want to see a feel good, sometimes feel not so good, trying to help the world bring to light the problems with addiction.
I'm just furthering your point when I say that there's a law in the state of California and probably in many other states that if you have sex with someone who's intoxicated, that can technically be rape. So 0.08, which is 2.5 beers, and you have sex with someone, and technically they're impaired, and it's rape. No one gets charged with it. But think about, there's a law there. So think about these producers getting people juiced up and then and then coaxing them and poking them with a stick and telling them to, you know, make it a little more salacious. And the next thing you know, you're saying stupid things that you wish you didn't in front of a camera in a national television audience.
Right.
All right. So that was your brother, who's now back to just working a restaurant. And he never got married to the chick or anything like that.
No.
And it turned out to be an embarrassment that you wish you'd never partake.
No, I don't know about did. Embarrassment. I mean, it was exciting. It just, it wasn't, it's just, it's funny. It's like a funny life lesson. It's like, oh man, this is going to be so much fun. This is going to be so much fun. This is going to be so much fun. And really, it's a little bit of a deal with the devil,
so
and it's not so much fun. And it's kind of a little bit, you know, I mean, it's
not fun.
It's not that it's not fun. I mean, like, I look at Ben Affleck and his, you know, brother is being nominated for Academy Awards. Like, my brother's got to really step it up, you know?
No shit. How about my sister? She ain't doing squat. All right. Jerry O'Connell, by the way, Jerry's going to be in Piranha 3D, which is going to be taking a bite out of a movie theater near you.
I made that one.
Up. In 2010, with Bing Rames, and Adam Scott is a really cool guy,
yeah,
by the way. Elizabeth, she's
really funny.
Adam's been on this show a few times. Also, fundraiser coming up for the Much Love Rescue.
Yes.
It's August 22nd.
Go to the Much Love website, muchlove.org. It's great. It's just a great charity. It's if you're going to adopt
a
pet,
puts them in homes, and then celebrities hit them with water bottles.
And yeah, no, I don't hit the dogs with the water bottle. I spray them.
Spray them. So.
It's a great website, and there it is, muchlove.org, and you can get all the information from there. And it's August 22nd.
Give my love to your beautiful wife.
I will.
And until next time, this is Adam Carolla for Jerry O'Connell, saying mahalo.
Follow Adam Carolla on Twitter at Adam Carolla. Reach him via Skype at Adam Podcast or through the mail at Adam Carolla Podcast, 10061 Riverside Drive, number 276, Toluca Lake, California, 91602.